India, dawn of new horizon. An excerpt from India, the light of the being. This book in particular deals with the spiritual horizon of India. Not a political India, but the spiritual India. Now, the excerpt, India, dawn of new horizon. It is from the series, India, my love, my being, my presence. India, dawn of new horizon. To me, India is the inner space of every meditator. It is journey towards the discovery of inner spiritual treasure. There is a spiritual part of India, which is beyond the material poverty and riches. That is your physical, that your physical eyes cannot envision. Your cameras cannot photograph it. Your training, your education cannot capture it. When you are connected to that innerness deep within, only then you are worthy of being called a citizen of India. Then it will not matter where you are born or grew up. All that will matter that you breathe the spirit of India. Your life will reflect the spirit of India. India is not a piece of land that was divided and subdivided many times. It is not verily a land that was invaded and ruled many times for various reasons. India is not just a piece of land that was ruled many times over the long period of history. It is something more than a mere piece of land. It is something more than a mere piece of land. It is consciousness. It is poetry and metaphor. It is consciousness. It is poetry and a metaphor. The real India is not visible to modern human eyes. To see and feel the innerness of India, you need to be a witness to your consciousness. India is vibrating a certain energy field which no other country can claim. Such energy field is the outcome of thousands of mystics meditating over a long period. From times immemorial, thousands of mystics and sages have meditated and thus attained to ultimate explosion of consciousness. It is indeed this explosion of consciousness that has created the energy field that India pulsates. It is the land of Buddha, Ram, Krishna, Mahavir, Vedavyas, sages, rishis, Valmiki, Vashishth, Tulsidas, Aurobindo, Nanak, Kabir, Nyandev, Meera, Ramakrishna, Chaitanya, Nivrittinath, Muktabai, Lalna, Sahajobai, Vivekananda, Kamban, Osho, Truvalluvar, Muinuddin Chishti, Nizamuddin Aulia, Sheikh Ahmed Mujaddidi Al-Thani, Naqshbandi Lalaji, Nanak, Kabir, Guru Gobind Singh, and many more, thousands of sages, masters and mystics have meditated. Their vibration is still alive. The horizon is overflowing their vibration. You need a certain perceptivity or meditative capacity to feel and receive the invisible, the unheard, the invisible that surrounds the land that is my love, my being, and my presence. You need a certain perceptivity or meditative capacity to feel and receive the invisible, the unheard and the invisible that surrounds the land that is my love, my being, my presence. A Naqshbandi Sufi Sheikh, Hazrat Amkarki, told his disciple Hazrat Baqiullah, I am sending you to a distant land whose very texture is soaked in spirituality. It is the land sanctified, nourished and nurtured by such forces from times immemorial. A land which is ready to explode any path. A land whose very texture is not only ready but has capacity to infuse life even in the dead heart. A land whose very being is not only ready but has the capacity to infuse life even in the dead heart. I am sending you to India. India has been the university of meditation and the beacon light not only now but from times immemorial. It has created many Buddhas. Verily, I speak to you of this India, that is my love, my being, my presence. This is the India to which every seeker looks to as the beacon light for inner journey and transformation. To this land, Lao Tse was drawn when at the end of his life's journey, he travelled on his water buffalo to reach the Sahasra, the thousand-petaled center, Himalayas of India, for meditative sojourn and dissolution in the ultimate. To this serene snow cave, thousand-petaled centers, Moses and the only begotten son Jesus was drawn for solitude and finally choose to merge in existence here. 25 centuries ago, with the enlightenment of Gautam Siddhartha, a new way of religiosity came into existence. Before Buddha, there were religions but not religiosity. Before Buddha, there were religions but never a pure religiousness. Man was not mature yet. With Buddha, humanity entered into a mature age. Buddha has opened the gateless gate. It takes time for a human being to understand such a deep message. Buddha's message is the deepest ever. Nobody has done the work that Buddha has done, the way he has done. Nobody else represents pure fragrance. Other founders of religions, other enlightened people have compromised with their audience. Buddha remains uncompromised. Hence his purity. He does not care what you can understand. He cares only what truth is. And he says it without being worried whether you understand it or not. In a way it looks hard, in another way this is great compassion. When a student like Subhati inquires something, Buddha has to respond. Thus emerged the Diamond Sutra. In response to Sariputra, Buddha gave the Heart Sutra. Padmasambha, the lotus born, was a sage king. Padmasambha, the lotus born, was a sage guru from Odiana who is said to have transmitted Vajrayana Buddhism to Bhutan and Tibet and neighboring countries in the 8th century. To those lotus land, in those lotus lands, he is better known as Guru Rinpoche. He said, my father is the intrinsic awareness, Samantabhadra, My mother is the ultimate sphere of reality, Samantabhadri. I belong to caste of no duality. I belong to the caste of non-duality, of the sphere of awareness. My name is the glorious lotus ball. I am from the unborn sphere of all phenomena. I consume concepts of duality as my diet. I act in the ways of Buddhas three times. According to traditions, Padmasambhava was incarnated as 8-year-old child, appearing in lotus blossom, floating in lake in the kingdom of Odia. Traditionally, it is identified with Swat Valley of South Asia, present-day Pakistan. It was Padmasambhava who gave the option, the Tibetan aspect of Vajrayana Buddhism. I am indeed elated, and I am speaking to you on a Tibetan Buddhist master. What excites me are three names: Tibet, Buddha, and Atisha. Tibet, that was once part of undivided India, is the only country in the world that has spent all energy for the development of human consciousness. Buddha gave Vipassana meditation and made enlightenment possible. And Atisha is the Buddhist master who left India to go to Tibet. Initially, Atisha was alone for 3 years. However, on reaching, Atisha decided to stay back in Tibet. Atisha, Deepankar, Shri Jan was born in 980 AD. Atisha is Buddhist teacher from Pala Empire, who along with Konchok, Gyalpo and Marpa became one of the major figures in the establishment of Sarma lineages in Tibet after the repression of Buddhism by King. Atisha is one of the rare masters. He is rare in the sense that he was taught by three enlightened masters in addition to 157 masters that he acquired. It has never happened before. Also, it is very rare that a master is trained by three masters. Atisha is a gift from India to Tibet, just as Bodhidharma is India's gift to China. From times immemorial, India had sent masters and missionaries to different parts of the world as its gift. It is from this eternal land Bodhidharma was invited by King of Wu Dynasty in China. And thus, with the union of Buddhism and the secrets of the golden flower, emerged the stream of China. To Mahakashyap Buddha, one morning in the commune at Avantipindika near Shravasti, gave the unheard and unspoken energy field that reached far in the east to Japan as Zen Buddhism. Nearly 5,000 years ago, Shiva gave to the world the eternal message for inward journey as Vijnana Bhairava Tantra, as the only authentic treatise on meditation with 112 techniques of meditation. It was the inner soil of India that gave Vedas as the first spark of awareness. Upanishads, the Puranas, the Bhagavad Purana, the Bhagavad Gita, Ramayana, the Ramcharitmanas, the Adi Granth Sahib. In the ancient city of Varanasi in India, Shankar gave the message of Bhajgobinda. On this land was born Mahatma Ramchand, a Naqshbandi Sufi Sheikh, who among his followers and seekers is known as Lalaji. He is the harbinger of Indian stream of Naqshbandi Sufi order. He gave the message, his spirituality is beyond narrowness of all kinds. To rise beyond narrowness is the essence of truth. On this land was born a Buddha with unparalleled intelligence that set the wheel of Dhamma once again in motion. The world knows this light as Osho, whose light spreads beyond all known and unknown realms. It is on this eternal land that Krishna gave the immortal assurance to humanity. It is on this eternal land that Krishna gave the immortal assurance to humanity. Yada yada dharmasya glanir bhavati Abhyuttanam dharmasya tadatmanam srijami paritranaay sadhuna vinashaay cha dushkratam dharma sansthapanaay sambhavam yugi. To this eternal land India, that is my life, my being, my presence, a million salutations. Bharat Bhumi, samast divya atmaon ke atmik prakash se daityamaan hai. Aao is prakash punj se apne jeevan ki prajwalit karo. Aao is prakash punj se apne jeevan jyoti prajwalit karo. जीवन सुमन चलाकर तेरी हम अर्चना करेंगे, जन्म जन्म तेरी हम वंदना करेंगे। जीवन सुमन चलाकर तेरी हम अर्चना करेंगे, जन्म जन्म तेरी हम वंदना करेंगे। बाहुनी जीवन पुष्प तब चले, कीर्ति गाऊत जी चले चले। बाहुनी जीवन पुष्प तब चले, कीर्ति गांत जी जन्म जन्म। Embellishing life to be a flower for thy altar, I shall alone see thy glory. Satyam jayate, truth alone triumphs.